Past that you make everything beautiful. It's just what you do. I feel like that some of us know that in our heads but don't fully believe it in our hearts. And I feel like that there's kind of like a, just like that the Holy Spirit wants to just move that today from our heads down to our hearts. Part of that is like shifting our perspective, that we are seated with him. So just think about that, shifting our perspective from like being down here and just being like, God, you know what, I know you make everything beautiful, that's awesome, to being seated with him, because that's where we are, and declaring, you make everything beautiful in situations that don't look beautiful right now. Just declaring that over our hearts, declaring that over our families, declaring that like over our marriages, because God like sneezes and only goodness comes out, you know? Seriously, it's like so amazing. So we're just gonna sing it again, and we're just gonna shift this morning from, we're just gonna move it from here to here. That's what we're doing. And we're just gonna declare it. Wow. As you make everything beautiful. Wow.
Yeah. make your way back to your seats. And if the ushers could come forward. Funny, as we were just singing that, it seems ironic to me that the thing that God used to make everything beautiful was so ugly to the world. It was a shame to the world that the Son of God would come and die on a cross was. And it was an atrocity in the view of the world. But it's the very thing that the Father used to bring us home. And it seems like even in the things that are the worst in our life, because of what Jesus has done, beauty can grow out of those things. And so as you're receiving the elements, would you just take a moment to thank God for the things in your life that looked like atrocities? But how he's turned them to beauty. And maybe you're still in the process of one of those things. And as you hold the elements in your hand, you get the opportunity to remember that he is all powerful. He is all powerful. Scripture says that on the night before Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body that's broken for you. Eat and remember." Let's go ahead and take the bread. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. And in the same way, he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood that was shed on behalf of you. Drink this and remember me." Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. We're going to go back into worship for just another minute because he's so worthy of our praise. Just join me.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, He is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, He is my song, and You are good. You are good. Ooh, you are good. Good.
every time. Thank you, Father. We just give him a shout of praise. I'm Shannon McLeod. I'm one of the pastors on staff here at Grace Center. Wow, that was awesome. Do we have any first-time visitors? Yes? Yes! Yay, welcome. Glad you're here. And we want to welcome all the people who are tuning in online. Welcome. We're happy that you're here. We're going to just transition right now into a time of receiving our tithes and offerings. And so at Grace Center, we like to make some declarations so that our hearts and our values and our wallets line up with the kingdom of God, because it works better that way. How many of you have found that out? It works better that way, right? So if you would just join me and stand, we're going to get the declarations up there. And go ahead and just say these with me. As we pray for new wells of revival, we pray for new economic wells in our city to be created. So, Lord, we ask you for favor for our city with CEO, government leaders and kings, manufacturing firms that produce goods for the nations and provide new jobs for our people. Technology to establish new markets, energy sources, and efficient solutions to grow as a population. Courts that measure with the justice and the freedom of your kingdom. Civil servants that encourage entrepreneurs. Media known for wisdom and truth. Natural resources released, harvested, sold, and reproduced. Education, books, and universities that develop godly mind molders who influence the influential. Capital to build small businesses that provide services, arts, and culture, attracting both young and old. Medical community known for integrity and excellence. Repentance from poverty, small thinking, and envy. Courage to recognize opportunities and make wealth. Abundance to bless the world and the prudence to save and invest. Revelation to pass on wealth to our children's children. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of our financial needs, that we may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. As you're getting seated and the ushers are passing the bags, I would like you guys to just go ahead and turn your attention to the screen for all of our many video announcements.
Good morning, Grace Center. We're so glad that you're here with us today. If you're a first-time visitor, welcome. If you have any questions or need help with directions, look for people wearing a Grace Center badge and they will be happy to help you.
Dad Me is an overnight camping adventure with Dad on June 3rd to the 5th at Long Mountain. This is a great opportunity for dads to bond with their kids over activities like a ropes course, a zip line, tree swing, games, hikes, canoeing, fishing, capture the flag, and more. Tickets include the cost of activities, supplies for the camp, meals, and s'mores, and can be purchased now at gracecenter.us.
Our annual Moore Conference is just 3 weeks away. Joining us on May 20th and 21st will be Jesus Culture Worship Leader Chris McLarney and Danny Silk from Bethel Church in Redding, California. Tickets are now on sale at gracecenter.us.
This one's for all the guys. You're invited to our monthly men's meeting on May 15th at 5 p.m. We have discovered that for the most part, men have been left on their own to try to figure out life and to write their own life's map without much help. We are convinced that the only way to navigate this journey as men is to connect with each other on a more authentic level. When we have the freedom to share life's triumphs and disappointments, we discover together that we are not alone, but we are all sons learning to relate to our Heavenly Father, even in our imperfections. And we can be free to be who we were created to be. So, we hope to see you on the 15th. A suggested donation of $5 will be collected at the door. Register at gracecenter.us.
Our spring Wednesday night classes are starting on May 4th. AJ Jones will be teaching her class on sonship, which you may remember from her teachings on sonship in March. In this four-week study, we will be taking an in-depth look at the five stages of sonship and will learn how to identify where we may be stuck and how we can continue to mature in sonship. In Couples Connection, led by Mike and Phyllis Best, couples will learn how to grow their heart connection, spiritual connection, physical connection, and community connection. In Healthy Living with our chiropractor friend, Dr. Ronson Dykstra, we'll learn the habits of healthy lifestyle that will help us to steward our bodies well. Then, on June 1st and June 8th, we will have a special two-week class on creativity taught by Ray Hughes. Ray has traveled the world for over 40 years as an author, storyteller, songwriter, and poet. Find more details about classes and register online at gracecenter.us.
Are you interested in the School of Supernatural Life? Applications for the 2016-2017 school year for the School of Supernatural Life are open through June 15th. To apply, go to gracecenter.us/school.
We are sending a team to our adopted African village of Shweba this August. The deadline to apply for this trip is today. On the trip, we will minister to children, connect with leaders, and build bridges between Grace Center and our family across the world. Apply today at gracecenter.us/Shweba.
Check your bulletin to learn about all the upcoming events at Grace Center. You can also sign up for our weekly email newsletter on the homepage at gracecenter.us.
Just a reminder that the National Day of Prayer is this Thursday, May 5th. Take a look at the handout that you got this morning to join thousands in praying for our nation and our leaders. Also, this Tuesday, May 3rd, Franklin Graham will be at the Legislative Plaza with a Decision America tour. To learn more, check out this video.
In 2016, I'm traveling to all 50 states to hold prayer rallies, calling our nation to God. We're calling it the Decision America tour. We're asking people to pray, to vote, and engage in your community. I hope all of you churches will join me for the Decision America Tour, where we're going to be on the Capitol steps praying for our country. Because if the Church of Jesus Christ would take a stand, then I believe we have hope for America.
Amen. So I hope you guys can make that. For all of you that work downtown Nashville, you could skip over at noon over at Legislative Plaza and meet us there. That'd be awesome. Well, good morning, Grace Center. How are you? Four of you? Good, good, good. Good morning, Grace Center. How are you? All right, awesome. Hey, let's do this real quick, if you would. Stand up again. Turn to the people around you and say, good morning. My name is this your first time here? Really good to see you. Where are you from? Okay. All right. Awesome. That's pretty cool. From up here, it looks like you guys did the sit-down wave. Like, it started in the back. People started sitting down, just kind of went all the way up to the front. It's pretty, I guess you had to be there. Anyway. So, everybody good? Four? Awesome. Everybody good? Good in the back? All right. Awesome. Good deal. So this morning, we've got a very special guest that, are you doing? Ah, awesome. Yeah, there you go. So he did a different message first service, which I told him, I said, you know, if you feel like doing a different message second service, please do so. But with us this morning is a very special friend of ours now, if I could say that. I don't know if I can trade on that, but anyway. No, but seriously, no. One of the churches that's influenced Grace Center a lot has been Bethel Church in Reading with Bill Johnson and Chris Valentin and those guys. Danny Silk will be here. And lo and behold, one of their dear friends that they give great accolades to is Dick Joyce. And... No, but it's a heartfelt. I didn't realize that you knew Bill's dad that before. Yeah, and so Bill was talking about that. And Bill actually talked about when of all the years that they were in Weaverville that you helped them out the most, and they are greatly appreciative of that. And so anyway, he's with us. He's got family that's here in town, and we kind of met up. Our paths crossed. Here we go, speech dyslexia. Anyway, our paths crossed about almost a year ago, and we connected last year, and I said, man, you know what? If you're ever back in town, we'd love to have you. So he's here with us today and is going to bring a message. And so if you would, I want to bring up Dick Joyce. Could you give a warm Grace Center welcome to Dick Joyce?
Here this morning. I'm leaving. How many of you are glad to be here this morning? And how many of you are glad Jesus is here too? I'm telling you, if this kind of atmosphere doesn't light your fire, your wood's wet. There is something supernatural about this place. I like it here. Hallelujah. That introduction perplexed me a little bit. I had to dive from my dictionary when Pastor said that Bethel Church gives me accolades.
It's good. It's a good.
How many? I have no idea what an accolade is, but I'm glad to get them. Hallelujah. I'm virtually unknown here. How many of you have never seen me before? Can I? Wow. Where have you been? It is a delight to be invited, an honor to be invited to Grace Center. And I want to come right to the Word. Sometimes I go to a place and I have to take 15 minutes to warm them up. You guys are not warm, you're hot. So I want to take you right to the Word, speak what I believe the Word of the Lord is for this moment. What I'd like you to do is stretch your hand out to where I'm standing. And in that gesture, you symbolize two things. Number one, we bless the man that's come with the Word. Don't know a whole lot about him. Don't care a whole. No, I mean, but we're blessing. But secondly, beyond that, it says, I'm not going to sit here passively for the next little while and listen to a sermon. I'm going to grab this. I'm going to make it part of my life. So, Father, I pray one more time, anoint my lips. Anoint the ears of your people. If there are unsaved people here, Lord, I pray, create faith in Jesus. If there are people that have never been baptized in the Holy Spirit, as I'm preaching, Lord, fall on them. Yeah. If there are people that need physical healing, while I'm preaching, you said you sent your word and healed them. So while I'm preaching, let healing be going on. But above everything else, glorify the name of Jesus. Because we don't want to walk out of here in a little while and say that was a good service. We want to leave here and say, what a great Savior. What an awesome Jesus. So do your work, Lord, through your word. In Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen, 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 amen. About 4 months ago now, I think, maybe three, God woke me up at about 4 a.m. It was still dark out. And as I opened my eyes, he said, I've got a new assignment for you. I slipped on my bathrobe and sat in my easy chair and waited to hear what the new assignment would be. And as over a period of about an hour, God began to germinate this thing in me, he said, from now on, wherever you go, I want you to do two things. Number one, I want you to encourage my people to pray. And then secondly, he said, I want you to challenge my people to pray. Is there anybody here that suspects I might be preaching this morning on the subject of prayer? Very shrewd. Is there anybody here that says, oh no, another sermon on prayer? Dick, I already pray so much. I am so fanatical and so powerful in prayer that what I really need is not somebody to come here to try to encourage me or challenge me to pray. What I need is somebody to come to this pulpit and preach a sermon on the subject, how not to pray so much. No, nobody with that burden. Okay. If you have a Bible, open it. Or for the younger people, turn it on. Luke's Gospel, chapter 18. I was first starting out in traveling ministry. The year was 1969. They invited me to preach at a great church where the pastor was a great man of God. He picked me up at the airport, and we're on the way to the hotel, and I thought, I want to pick his brain. I want to find out what makes him such a powerful man of God and what has built this into being such a great church. And it hit on me to ask him about his prayer life. And I said, brother, how long do you spend in prayer every day? He's kind of a crusty old man. And he fired back at me. He said, son, I don't pray by the clock. I pray by the Spirit. Then he saw a gleam of laziness in my eye as though he had said, I don't pray very much. And so he repeated himself and said, I don't pray by the clock, I pray by the Spirit. But son, if you don't know how to pray by the Spirit, you'd better pray by the clock. It seems to me that encapsulates what Jesus is talking about in this parable that he's going to give us in Luke chapter 18. Do you have it already? We're going to talk about the parable, but let me give you first Jesus' introduction to that parable. He told them a parable. What's a parable? It's an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. He told them this parable to illustrate that it is necessary always to pray and not to faint. A couple of things by introduction. What did Jesus teach about prayer? First of all, when God's people would pray. When are they to pray? When am I to pray? When are you to pray? Notice the key word. What is it? Always. In other words, my people are going to be a people who are bathed in prayer. They're going to open their eyes in the morning, and prayer will somehow just issue out of their hearts. I have a habit. I go to bed at night. Well, that's not my habit. I mean, I'm going to say something about going to bed at night. When I'm drifting off to sleep, I say, Lord, would you give me a song as I open my eyes in the morning? This morning, I opened my eyes and an old song came to me. The reason an old song came to me is, don't dare say it. I'm old. And somehow the Holy Spirit takes me back to the old well, and I opened my eyes this morning, and it just came. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. The old people are singing with me. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. And as that song came, it sort of ignited my spirit. And then I did something that I've done every morning since the year 1969. What does that do? That activated my spirit. The genuine Christian is not going to be a man or a woman who tags prayer on to the end of life. It's a person that bathes himself, herself, in the presence of the living God. Pray always. Go through the day in prayer, Jesus is saying here. It'll be the breath that you breathe, the air that you breathe. But notice something else that Jesus says even before we get to the parable. He gave this parable on the necessity of prayer. In other words, he's saying, for you, for me, prayer is not optional. Take it or leave it, cafeteria style. Prayer is an absolute necessity. My wife is in heaven. Lou was a good cook. And she discovered early in our marriage that I like chocolate cake. Anybody with me on that one? And she'd bake chocolate cake. And she baked a chocolate cake to make you speak in tongues. And then she would take the cake and she'd put chocolate frosting on it. There's nothing like chocolate cake with chocolate frosting. Let's dismiss and go to... But you know what? Chocolate cake is really good even without the frosting.
That's right.
Hey, pastor's getting blessed. You know you're doing okay when pastor's blessed. Chocolate cake is just plain good, with or without frosting, is optional. Could I say to you this morning that if you're a true believer in Jesus, prayer is not the frosting on the cake. It's the cake. And if you miss the cake, if you miss prayer, you've missed it all. Contrary to what some are teaching these days. You know, we have a line in the sand. On one side are the people that are called cessationists, that believe that, that the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the supernatural ended with the final days of the apostles. And on the other side of the line, and I think this church is on this side of the line, where you still believe in the supernatural and you still believe that that God moves today. We're called continuationists because we believe that that everything that Jesus did 2,000 years ago, he's doing now. But it seems to me, I might be wrong, but it seems to me that on this side of the line, those who are cessationists essentially say that the Christian life is a doctrine to be believed and an ethic to be followed. Could I say to you, it is a doctrine. I believe in sound doctrine. I believe in good, solid, biblical theology. I believe there's an ethic to be followed, a lifestyle. Oh, but listen to me. Christianity is more than a doctrine or an ethic. It's a relationship. It's an experience of God himself. And so Jesus is telling this story saying, listen, if you're one of my followers, how many of you want to be followers of Jesus? If you're one of my followers, prayer will be an essential, vital part of your life. Now he gives a parable to illustrate that. Let's look at the parable. There was, in a certain city, a judge that did not fear God nor regard man. This judge is hard. He's cruel. He's tough. And that's the first person of the parable. The second person is a widow. Jesus says about her, she was in that city, and she came up to this judge saying, and it's the only word he puts in her mouth, avenge me of my adversary. I don't know if you do this. I like to live into a portion of Scripture. I like to see. I like to put myself in it and experiencing. I see this judge sitting perhaps at his desk, surrounded by people who are presenting their petitions. And suddenly the door opens. And in the midst of the dignity and the decorum of this courtroom, this woman bursts in and with a loud voice, she says, avenge me of mine adversary. Every eye is on her. Who is this woman? What right does she have to come in here? And the judge, calming the situation down, calls her over and Jesus didn't tell the story this way. I'm letting my imagination go. I trust it's a sanctified imagination. The judge says to her, what is it? And I hear her saying, well, Your Honor, my husband passed away, and I have three children to take care of, and something has happened. A relative of my deceased husband is by fraud trying to get the property away from me, trying to take my inheritance away from me. And if he succeeds, I have no way of providing for my family. Your Honor, avenge me of mine adversary. The judge, maybe seeing the opportunity for what we call in Mexico a mordida. How many of you don't speak Spanish? Can I see your hand? Okay. I want to suggest that you start learning Spanish. The reason is because that's the language we're going to speak when we get to heaven. I think this is my second time this year preaching in English. But at any rate, the judge sees an opportunity for mordida, a little bribe. I kind of need to explain that culturally. In Jesus' day, there were dishonest, corrupt politicians. Thank God there are none any longer. Well, if I help you, ma'am, what's in it for me? And she says, Your Honor, I have nothing. I'm a poor widow. And seeing that he's not going to get anything, the judge says, get her out of here. And they haul her out, but as she's leaving, she's calling behind her, avenge me of mine adversary, avenge me of my adversary. And the judge, feeling good, says, I got rid of her. That's what he thinks. There was something about this woman that said, I'm desperate. I've got to get to that judge. I've got to touch that judge's heart somehow. And as the judge leaves his court that evening, who's waiting for him out in the corridor? The widow. And what does she say? Avenge me of my adversary. I see that judge running down the corridor and through a labyrinth of alleyways and streets, and the woman chasing him. Avenge me of my adversary. He escapes, gets home. He says to his wife, whew, there's this woman that has such a desperate need, and I don't want to help her. But I got rid of her. That's what he thinks. He goes up to bed that night. At 1 o'clock in the morning, the sound of pelting stones against the window. He goes and he opens the window, and who's waiting for him down in the moonlight? The widow. And what does she say? Avenge me of mine adversary. There was something about this woman that while everybody else was comfortable in bed, while everybody else was asleep, she said, my need is so great. I need to get to that judge. Notice what Jesus says about that judge. And he would not for a while. How long? I don't know. A month? 2 months? I don't know. But this judge would not for a while. But then listen to what Jesus said about him. Though I do not fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow troubles me, not because I care about her, not because I want to help her, not that I have compassion, she's just a bother to me. I have one kind of a translation or transliteration that says, I'm afraid of this woman's intensity. I'm afraid she's going to jump on me. Have you ever prayed with that kind of intensity? I've discovered something. I was moved by that Franklin Graham video. This nation needs more than now I lay me down to sleep prayers. This nation needs a passionate crying out to God. God, you'll either move in revival in our nation or we're dead. Come on. But this judge says, though I do not fear God nor man, yet because this woman troubles me, yet I will avenge her. And then Jesus gives his application of this story. I love it. Verse number 7. And shall not God avenge his own elect and be patient with them who cry out to him day and night? I tell you, he will avenge them speedily. That's the parable. Now, I want to make some comments on it. I have to confess to you that when I was a young preacher, how many believe I used to be young? When I was a young preacher, I would not preach on this parable. because it didn't compute. Didn't make sense. I understood that in the parable, I'm the widow. You're the widow. Oh, I don't know about you. I've got needs. Anybody here with any needs? I'm that widow with such needs that if the judge doesn't come through, I'm cooked. I've had it. I've got needs. I've got financial needs. So do you. I've got emotional needs. So do you. As I said earlier, my wife is in heaven. How many of you understand being a Christian doesn't automatically give you the perfect marriage? Come on, don't look so sanctified. One husband, one wife just nudged her husband. I told the first congregation, the first service, my wife and I were married for 37 years, and in 37 years of marriage, we never had one argument. No, we didn't. We had no argument. We had a lot of intense fellowship. In fact, in 37 years of marriage, we never once talked about divorce. Murder many times. And I'm talking to some people today that have areas of need. I'm not going to take time to delineate all of the needs. You know what I'm talking about. Maybe it's a financial need, a physical need. The doctor has given you some bad news, an emotional need. You fill in the blanks. I understood. I'm the widow. I've got needs, desperate needs. My problem was that I thought, as I puzzled over this, if I'm the widow, then Jesus must be teaching here that God is the judge. And this is why I wouldn't preach on it. Because I instinctively know, and you do too, that God is not that hard-nosed, corrupt, uncaring judge that this man was. And I couldn't understand why in the world is Jesus talking about this judge as though, and so as a young Christian, I got the idea. Prayer must be coming to God, engaging the judge who really doesn't want to do much for you. Isn't that what Jesus put in the words of this judge? Not because I care about her. And somehow, if I could get God in a full Nelson and somehow cause him to be bothered by me, he eventually would say, okay, you got me, you got what you want, but don't bother me for the next 3 months. And I was a young Baptist preacher boy. I'm in Tennessee, everybody's Baptist here. And my Baptist, we were good Baptists, I mean, you know, fighting fundy Baptists. And my pastor would come in the prayer service. We had prayer meeting every Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. And pastor would say, okay, brothers and sisters, tonight we're going to bombard the gate of heaven. And I translated that. The prayer then must be you take a battering ram and you rush against the door of heaven. And somehow, nobody ever taught me this, that somehow at 6:45, God was in heaven and he's saying, those Baptists are going to come in 15 minutes and they are going to bombard my gate and I don't want to give them much. Barricade the doors. And at 7 o'clock, we'd get our grenades and we'd toss them against the door of heaven. And at 7:15, God would say, would you look at what those Baptists are doing to my door? Plan B. What's plan B? Take down the barricades. Open the door. Give them something, not much, but give them something to keep them satisfied so they won't bother me till next Wednesday. That's what the judge says. Not because I care about her. If that's prayer, I'm not going to pray very much. If God is that tough, cruel, hard judge, doesn't encourage me to pray very much. Well, then, what in the world is this parable about? If I am the widow, but God is not that judge, let me try to get it to you. Are you still awake?
Yes.
If you're sound asleep, shout, amen. Let me try to get this to you as quickly as I can. There are some parables that are parables of comparison. The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed. This parable isn't a parable of comparison. There are other parables that are parables of contrast. That's this one. What Jesus is doing in this parable, this is so kindergarten, but I just feel like I got to get it to you. Jesus is saying, if that judge, hard, tough, cruel, corrupt, if that judge finally came across, how much more shall your God who's in heaven, and then notice what he says about that God in heaven, shall not his elect cry out to him day and night? In other words, Jesus is saying that from the eternal throne of heaven, before you were ever born, God looked down the corridor of years before the foundation of the world, the Apostle Paul says, and he said, I choose him. Come on. I don't know if that excites you. That gets me kind of going. When I start doing this when I'm preaching, that means I'm getting excited. That God that chose you before you even had existence, look down the corridor of years, before Joyce was ever conceived, before there were stars and moon and suns and planets, that God looked down the corridor of years and said, I choose him. Come on. You put your own name in that blank. Before you were ever born, God chose you. I have to be honest with you. I don't know why God chose me. I know me. I would never have chosen me. Don't laugh. I wouldn't have chosen you either. Jesus is saying here, you're not coming to a corrupt judge. You're coming to a God who, before you were ever conceived, brought you into being, elected you, chose you, and then the day came when you heard the gospel. How did that happen? I don't know. You know your history. Maybe over a cup of coffee, somebody shared the good news of the gospel. Maybe you watched a television program. Maybe you came to a church. I don't know how it happened, but you heard the word of the gospel, and the Holy Spirit created faith in you, and your faith rose up, and you grabbed that and said, I believe that though I am a sinner deserving of hell, though I have offended a holy God, that God has chosen me, that God is now going to be my God, and you came to Jesus as Savior and Lord of your life. What is Jesus saying in this parable? If that God chose you before eternity and caused you to be born again through faith in Jesus, if that God chose you and brought you into being, how much more than that judge will God the Father give and 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 give to his sons and his daughters? Most of you here, I'm looking around, are parents. As parents, do you love to give to your kids? Jesus put it this way: if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more, that's this parable, how much more shall your Father give? In one place he says, give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him. In another place he says, give good gifts to those that ask him. How many of you are parents? Do you like to give to your kids? How much more shall your Father give? Lou and I had two sons. One of them, Ryan, is sitting right here. And my other son, my older son, is Michael. One year, they came to me, I think it was in July, and they said, Dad, we'd like new bicycles for Christmas. Well, all right. But no smart parent will tell their kid in July what they're going to get in December. And so I wanted to throw them off. And I said, oh, kids, bicycles are so expensive these days. And offerings have been really low in the churches that I've gone to. And money is not good. No, there's no way we can. We'd already bought the bikes. They were hidden in a neighbor's garage. And came December 24th. And I said to the kids, they were pretty small then. And I said, okay, kids, go up to bed. As soon as they were asleep, my wife and I sneaked out, went to the neighbor's house, got the bikes, brought them, wheeled them into the living room. And I wanted to see how they reacted. I wanted to see their look, the look on their faces when they got those bikes. I knew they were going to get up real early on Christmas morning. On school days, you couldn't get them up with a... But on Christmas. And so I hid so that they couldn't see me. And they came down the stairs and they went into the living room. And they saw these new bikes that they didn't think they were going to get. And they jumped and they hugged each other. Miracles do happen. And finally, one of them said to the other, let's try them out. And it was still dark out. We lived on a cul-de-sac where there's no traffic. And they wheeled their bikes right by me and never saw me. And I went to the window and I opened the window and peeked outside. And I'm telling you, those kids rode those bikes around and around and around with such joy. But they didn't have a tenth of the joy that Daddy had. Because there's something in Father's heart that wants to give and give and give and give and give. Jesus is saying, I encourage you to pray. I want you to pray. I want you to bathe your heart in prayer. I want you to bathe your life, not just in coming to ask for things, although that's valid and good and right, but just, I just want to be with you, Daddy. I just want to be in your presence. I said earlier that I am like that widow. You are like that widow. But there are some differences, too, between that widow and me and that widow and you. First difference is she came to a judge with no promise that that judge was ever going to help her. He had not said to her, if you come, I will do something for you. Ah, when I come in prayer, I come with a Bible full of promises. No matter what my need is, do I have a financial need? I come before my Father and I say, your word says, my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Corrie ten Boom. I had the privilege of ministering with her years and years ago in one conference. And Corrie ten Boom used to say, when she had a financial need, she said, I come before God and I say, Lord, you own the cattle on a thousand hills. Why don't you sell one of your cows? I need the money. You have a financial need, you got a promise in the Word. You have a physical need, you come and there's a promise in the Word. By His stripes, I was healed. And if I was, I am. I told the congregation the first service, a little more than a year ago, I had my annual physical, and I went home. A few days later, the doctor called. And he said, Mr. Joyce, you need to come back to my office. There are some issues we need to talk about. When the doctor tells you that, it's probably not to congratulate you on your good health. And so I went back, and he's looking at his chart, and he says, you have a disease called hemochromatosis. It's a disease that destroys the liver, it destroys the heart, and it's invariably, sometimes takes a long time, but it's invariably fatal. Let me tell you what my first thought was when he said, you've got hemochromatosis and it's fatal. I thought, well, if I'm going to die, it might as well be of something I can't pronounce. And he said, you need to go to a specialist who'll confirm this thing. So I made an appointment, went to the specialist, and he's looking at my chart, and he says, you've got hemochromatosis, no doubt about it. But he said, we're going to do one more test. This test isn't whether to find out whether or not you've got the disease. It's to find out how far it's gone. In other words, how much time you have left. I went from that office. That week, I happened to be attending a meeting in a small church where Randy Clark was ministering. How many can see where this story is going? Randy's in the middle of a message. It's about 4 days after my appointment with the specialist, and my telephone rang. And I recognized the doctor's number, and I slipped out of the auditorium. And when I talked to the doctor, he said, I don't understand this. I think I did. And he said, 10 days ago, you had a fatal disease, hemochromatosis, but something has happened, and this latest test indicates you don't have anything. Hallelujah! What happened? What had happened? Listen, the word, the promise, canceled the verdict of the doctor. She came with no promise. She came to that judge. He was hard. He was cruel. When I come to the judge of the universe, I suddenly discover that judge is my Father who called me and chose me. Am I encouraging you a little bit in your prayer life? I got to come in for an emergency landing here. Gotten anything out of all this? Good. Well, let's come to the final thought then. And shall not God, this is Jesus' commentary on the parable, and shall not God avenge his own elect who cry out to him day and night? By the way, one of the evidences that you are truly one of God's elect is something within you that cries out to God day and night. I don't want to hit you over the head with the Bible, with a sermon that says, you gotta pray more. We all know that. And I understand there may be moments of mountain praying where your heart is just on fire and I understand. There also may be moments of valley when you don't really feel like praying. When you wake up in the morning, do you always feel spiritual? Come on. I understand. There may be mountains and there may be valleys in this thing called prayer life, but I'm declaring to you, if there's not something in your heart that's drawn toward fellowship with God, if there's not something in your heart that says, I need him, I need relationship with him, then maybe you better go back and check your foundations. His people will cry out to him day and night. That word cry out, and here's where I kind of want to wind this down. That word cry out is a very powerful word, very interesting word. The Greek word is boao. Would you say that word with me? Boao. Not bow wow. Boao. What does that word boao mean? In the English language, the cow says moo. In the Greek language, they conceived the Greek that the New Testament was written in, that the cow said, boao. What does that have to do with prayer? Jesus is making a point here. Is he saying, I'm going to go around all day? Moo. Moo. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever had a need that was so deep? Maybe a wound. Maybe a divorce that you never wanted. Maybe the death of a loved one unexpectedly. Maybe you thought you were going to get a promotion and you walked in and they fired you. Whatever. Was so deep that you couldn't even pray. All you could do was walk around saying, oh God, oh God. That's a boao moment. Oh God. And what Jesus is saying is that the Holy Spirit will take that groaning, Paul calls it, that cannot be uttered, and take it and carry it to the throne of God. And that boao, that oh God, becomes the most eloquent prayer of the universe. Jesus told this story on the necessity, not the option, the necessity of bathing my life in prayer. And I'm going to finish here. How many times have I said I'm going to finish? My wife told me that every Pentecostal preacher gets a right to 5 conclusions. But this is the real one. Take courage. It's the real one. Jesus said, on the necessity to always pray, and then the King James says, not faint. Jesus only offered you 2 alternatives. There's no third alternative. You'll either pray or you'll faint. You'll either pray, you'll either bathe your life in prayer, or you'll discover that you're going to get washed out of this thing. Something in me says, oh God, I want to take the first alternative. I want to pray. I want to bathe my heart, bathe my life in prayer. I want to know what it means to what I said in the first service, stand on the mountain of God, my feet firmly planted on earth, but on the mountain of God, and breathe the air of heaven. Are you with me on that? So the question is, Are you praying the way this widow prayed? Are you satisfied with the way you have, like this widow, presented your needs before God? And even more importantly, is God satisfied with my prayer life? Would you close your eyes? Lift your head. Don't crunch your head down, child of the King. The writer to Hebrews says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So lift your head before your Father. Just make an altar right where you are. And ask him, Father, are you satisfied with my level of prayer? Are you satisfied with the quality of my prayer, with the quantity of my prayer? God, I love you so much, Father, that I want you to be satisfied with me. Make an altar right where you are. Let him evaluate you. Don't judge yourself. Let him. He's always a kinder judge than you are. We used to sing an old song when I was a kid. You may not know it, but learn it with me. It said this: to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus, all I ask, to be like him, all through my journey from earth to glory, all I ask, to be like him. Stand up. And if you don't know it, learn it with me. To be like Jesus, to be like Jesus, all I ask, to be like him all through my journey. All through my journey from earth to glory, from earth to glory, all I ask, to be like him. A couple of things, I'm going to turn the microphone back. We used to sing that song when I was a kid. We came from a very similar background, where when we sang to be like Jesus, what it translated in our minds was this: don't go here, don't go there. Come on. Don't do this, don't do that. I need to tell you, being like Jesus is a whole lot more than don't. Jesus was a man of prayer. And if Jesus, as Son of God, God incarnate, needed to pray, how much more I need to pray? How much more you need to pray? I used to give invitations, and I know it's late, but one of the things I appreciate, I have visited, I think, two times previously to this church. This is a church of a the presence of God. This is a church that says we always have time for the Holy Spirit. I used to give invitations after preaching on prayer, and it's about all I preach on these days. And I'd say, if you want to commit to spend 1 hour a day in prayer, come forward. Maybe out of a crowd like this, half a dozen people, you know, the marathon runners, they'd come forward. And then I'd lower the bar and I'd say, well, 45 minutes and maybe you get a couple more, and 30 minutes and maybe quite a few more, and 15 minutes and the majority. I'd never go below 15 minutes. If you can't pray 15 minutes a day, I've got advice for you, get saved. I don't give that kind of invitation anymore. 15 minutes, 30 minutes, 45 minutes. Why? Because there's a prophet in the Old Testament, I think it was Zechariah, who said, in the last days, we're there, folks, in the last days, the spirit of prayer will rest on the people of God. What does that mean? That means that when you wake up in the morning, Jesus said it here, the necessity of praying always. When you wake up in the morning, it'll be in prayer. As you go through the day, the presence of God will be upon you. I said to the first service, there's a danger in a church like this. There is. There's a danger in a church like this, a great church that loves the presence of God. And the danger is this, that I could come once a week, twice a week, warm my hands at somebody else's fire, and the rest of the week live as cold as a dead ember. The spirit of prayer, the prophet said, would rest on the people of God. I want to pray one more prayer. And I don't know how to do this even, but we're going to do it. Has God said anything to you that you need to adjust your life by from what you've heard this morning? If he has, and you say, I don't know all that it means, I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm not going to be content just to go once or twice a week and warm my hands. I want to have my own glory. I want to have my own intimacy with God. There are some people who are already PhDs in prayer. There are some who are just starting out in spiritual kindergarten. But wherever you are, and you say, I need that spirit of prayer to rest on me. I want God to be available. I want me to be available to God so that if God wants to wake me up at 3 o'clock in the morning and says, son, daughter, I'm calling you to prayer, I'm not going to pull the pillow over my head and rebuke the devil. I'm going to respond to the call of God. If my normal time to get up is at 7 o'clock in order to get to work, and God says, get up at 6 o'clock, I'm available. If during the course of the day, God says to me, pull over by the side of the road and pray for 3 minutes, I'll do that, whatever it takes. I want to be a man or a woman that Jesus is talking about that's in the presence of God. If that's you, I'm going to pray a prayer on the count of three. Don't just kind of, well, this would be nice. I want you to put intensity in it. I want you to put passion in it, because you see, Jesus prayed with passion. Here we go. You can come. I'm going to pray a prayer, and then I'm going to turn it over to the pastor, see what the Holy Ghost is going to do. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Come on. I want to commit that the spirit of prayer is going to rest on me, whatever it takes. Gather it. Oh, God's on her. Father, in Jesus, as you get here, just raise your hands, raise your heart, raise yourself to God and say, God, I want what I've heard this morning. I want to be like that widow, if it means being at 2 o'clock in the morning, if it means whatever it is, Lord. Father, Forgive me for spiritual laziness. I want this to be the beginning of a new chapter, a new day in my life. If you want to wake me up at 3 o'clock in the morning, I'll be available. If you want to wake me up at 5 o'clock in the morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, if during the course of the day you want to pull me over by the side of the road, Lord, I'm ready. I want to be an instrument of prayer in your hands. Here it goes. Just lift your voice before God right now. Make commitment before him. Father, in the name of Jesus, we make ourselves available to you. Here it is. Father, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, this young man right here, what's your name, son?
Jordan.
I want everybody to stretch your hand toward Jordan. There is something. Take your hands and put them here on my body. And I don't even know how to tell you to do this. It's spilling over to this guy right by his side, too. Pull the anointing out of me. Pull the anointing out of me. I've done this maybe half a dozen times, Pastor, in my whole ministry. Pastor, come here, please. As Elijah was walking along, no, I need this. As Elijah was walking along the road and came to a field where he saw a young man plowing with 12 oxen, Elijah took his mantle and set it upon the shoulders of the young man of God. So even this morning, well, it's afternoon now, even this afternoon, your Elijah, Jesus, is walking by you and he's saying, I'm putting a new mantle on you. I'm putting a mantle. You are going to be a flaming evangel. This is a prophecy that Bill Johnson gave me years ago, and I want to give it to this young man. I want to pass it on. Bill Johnson said to me, Dick, you are going to be an arsonist of the Lord. And he said, what's an arsonist? An arsonist is a person who goes around setting fires even where they don't want fires. I see you, Jordan, going to places where people are hard. I see you going to places where people are closed. I see you going to places where people are so secular that they're even saying God doesn't exist. The Spirit of the Lord upon you. There are going to be miracles and wonders and signs. There are going to be fire in your bones. There's going to be fire coming out of your mouth. And I see you, son, setting fires in many places where there are no fires. Settle it in your heart that God has his hand on you. You've got your plans, you've got your desires, you've got your wishes, but the Spirit of God speaks to me and says he's going to change your direction. He's going to He's going to invade with his plan. So, Lord, let a ton of glory, here it is. Let a ton of glory rest on him. Thank you, Father. Overflow here, Lord. Overflow here. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. There was, and I'm looking for him, a young man, African-American, kind of a tall young guy, way back there. Come here, get your roller skates on, son, and come down here. Quickly, 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 quickly. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Kureme. Real quiet. Kuraboshimrete. Wow. I didn't realize how big you were. I hope he likes this. I saw some. How old are you, son? 16. Wow. I don't know what this refers to. I saw a bunch of people around you. You were standing right over here, and I saw a bunch of people around you, and they had ropes like this around their hands. They were bound. They were in pretty bad shape. There was no freedom. But the Lord put a knife in your hand, and you were going around and you were slicing ropes. You are going to be a delivered deliverer. There is going to be in you a powerful ministry of releasing prisoners of the enemy. Releasing prisoners of the enemy. In fact, I want to give that to this whole church. I want to give that. This church is known nationwide as a worshiping church. This church is known nationwide, not just here. It's known nationwide as a church of the presence of God. But let me tell you, as I ministered to this, your name again?
Sam.
Sam, I guess I'd never ask you your name. And I didn't get it by word of knowledge. As I was ministering to him, seeing him cut ropes, what I saw was people coming into this place bound. It was like they had ball and chain on their feet, and they were dragging in under addiction. But in the presence of God, in the presence of God, could I say it one more time? In the presence of God, even before the preaching, their chains are going to fall off. They drag in chains, but they dance out in victory of the Lord. And whatever this means, Sam, whatever this means, you are going to be a key part of the ministry of deliverance, the ministry of setting people free. So, you love Jesus, right? I know you do. I know you do. And I don't know what this means, but I'm speaking the word, your whole family, coming into the kingdom of God. Father in Jesus, stretch your hand out towards them. Father, I release healing into these hands. I release faith into his heart. And as Jesus breathed on his disciples and said, receive the Holy Spirit. He's already got the Holy Spirit, but a new dimension of the Holy Spirit. Here it is. As Jesus breathed, so I breathe on you. Give him more, Lord. Give him more. 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 Oh, this sister right here, I don't think I'm going to minister to many people, but I've got to give you this. Stand up and hear the word first. Esther. Was the bride of a king. And there was a plot of the enemy to destroy the people of God. But Esther beautified herself, soaked in perfume, and even without invitation, went into the presence of the king. But then the king invited her, and he extended his scepter to her. She touched the top of his scepter, and he released authority to her. Spirit of the Lord is showing me, your new name is Esther, and the Spirit of the Lord is showing me that you are going to be a key. You're going to come before God. You're going to touch the top of his scepter and release the power of God into situations where there is no hope. You're going to release the power of God into situations in which the enemy has said, I've won, I've won, I've won. And you're going to lift your voice and you're going to declare, oh no, you haven't won. My God, my God, my God is able. Does this make any sense to you? Does this make any sense to you? This woman is a key to what God is doing in this place. Oh. I'm going to let go of her hands. Take it all. Take it all. Oh. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just worship. Just worship. Just worship. Just worship. I know it's late. If you got to go, you got to go. Just worship. Just worship. Something going on here. This is a good party. I've occasionally had this word before. This woman is God's honeybee. I don't mean she's gonna go around stinging people. I see her gathering sweetness and nectar from one flower and taking it to another. I see you going into places where people are really depressed. I don't know what this refers to. They are really depressed. You have been in the presence of God. And because of being in the presence of God, I see you taking nectar out of the presence. She's going to get me drunk. I'll get it. I see you taking nectar out of the presence of God and taking it to people who are depressed. There's going to be a word of counsel in your mouth. There's going to be a word of counsel that's going to be like honey. This is a mixed metaphor, I know. Honey poured into wounds of people, and the word that you speak is going to bring dynamic, positive, permanent healing in those people. So you take this, Father, in Jesus' name, fill her, fill her, fill her. Fill her up. If she gets any more, she's going to explode. Gosh! Just love on the Lord. Just love on the Lord. That's what it's all about. It's just love Jesus. Just love Jesus. We're almost done. But don't go out of this place empty. We're almost done. But don't go out of this place empty. One more. One more. One more. Let me get here. I know in the natural something about you, because while you were up here, they said you were one of the pastors and that you oversee, I guess, or have something to do with the school of ministry, a school of supernatural life. I know that in the natural, it's not by word of knowledge. But what I see, I've never had this word before. She was a honey. I'm getting all sorts of animal things here today. What is it? She was a honeybee. You're going to be a dragon of the Lord. Dragons breathe fire and knock down everything that opposes them. So you are going to breathe fire into the lives of people, but it's not going to be a destructive fire. It's going to be a constructive fire in many cases, But then there will be, I see a situation developing, I don't know what it is, I see a situation developing within like the next 6 months where the enemy is going to rise and say, you're not going any further than this. You're not, this is it. You're not going any further than this. You are going to breathe fire against the enemy, and you are going to see the enemy's decrees burn to ashes. Burn to ashes. Here it is. This woman is a powerful woman of God. This woman is a powerful woman of God, but she's going to have a mantle to throw over many. Stretch your hand. What's your name again?
Shannon.
Shannon. Stretch your hand out toward Shannon. Father, I speak that this is the beginning of a new boldness in her. I speak that this is going to be the beginning of a new boldness within her. There's going to be a new depth. Just put fire in her bones, Lord. Put fire in her. More. More. Ooh. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. I have learned in this thing, by the way, point of wisdom for you, never close your eyes when you're laying hands on people. I made that mistake once. And this woman, in fact, Rebecca, you know Rebecca. She went into this thing where she was doing like this. My eyes are closed. She headbutted me and I went down. A ton of glory, Lord. Go ahead, Brett, lay hands on you. More, Lord, more, Lord, more, Lord. More, Lord, more, Lord, more, Lord. I know I said one more. Will you give me one more? Will you give me one? I know it's late. And it isn't going to be too long because I'm getting hungry. Honey, come here. Come here. Kurabodene. I've had this several times lately in prophetic word. I come from Latin America where bullfights are a pretty prominent sport. And there comes a place in a bullfight where the torero, the bullfighter, he's played with that bull for 20 minutes. The enemy's tried to play with you. The enemy's tried to play games with you. You need to figure out what the bull needs to figure out. The cape is not your enemy. You've gone after capes. The cape is not your enemy. Satan is your enemy. But there comes a point in that bullfight where the bull is so deceived that the torero, the bullfighter, takes a sword and plunges it. I can't imagine the agony that that bull feels at that moment. And from the time you were a little girl, and this is the word that I'm receiving, there's been an agony in your spirit. You've cried out and said, there's got to be more, there's got to be more, there's got to be more to life than what I'm experiencing right now and what I've experienced since I was a little girl. Disappointment after disappointment after disappointment. It was all planned out, but it didn't work out. And the enemy took a sword and said, this one has so much potential. This one, if I ever let her free, is going to romp all over my kingdom. therefore the enemy took a sword and plunged it into your deeper most spirit, and there's been an agony, but the word of the Lord is right now, this day, this moment, not tomorrow, not 3 weeks from now, right now, God is pulling the sword out. God is pulling the sword out. Oh. And he's pouring oil in. You are not just going to sit on a bench and watch the game. You are not going to sit on a bench and watch others get anointing. You are going to have the anointing of Almighty God upon you in such a dimension that the words that you speak are going to be powerful words. The words that you speak are going to be positive words. The words that you speak are going to be healing words. You've known the agony. Therefore, you can have sympathy and compassion on those that are going through agony of spirit. I don't know if you prophesy or not, but get ready, honey. You're going to prophesy. You're going to lift up your voice and prophesy to individuals. So here it is. Take it. Oh! Did you see me push her down? They used to say, oh, what happens is you push them down. I wasn't anywhere near her. We could go on all afternoon, but we're not going to do it. Put your hands up in the air. Put your hands up in the air. Just say, God, I want to be everything you intended me to be. I want to fulfill my destiny. I want to walk in my calling. So I'm available to you, Lord. If you want to do it, wake me up at 3 in the morning. If you want to do it, wake me up at 6 in the morning. I'll be sensitive to you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Give the Lord a clap offering. Yeah, okay.
So just tell everybody real quick. So I just ask if he would give this house a father's blessing. And so, yeah.
Join hands. Join hands. Whoa. Father, you told me several years ago that when I went to a place, if they receive the word of the Lord, as it is the word of the Lord, not just the word of man, that I would have the authority to stand and put your blessing upon that place. And so since Pastor has asked this, and you told me several years ago that that would be my portion, I stand in the midst of this people and I speak fullness of the blessing of the Lord on this house. I speak the word that marriages that are on the point of disintegration would be healed in the name of Jesus. Marriages that are already strong and solid would be even more solidified and unified. I speak the homes of this congregation would become embassies of the kingdom of God. I speak that as embassies in the natural national embassies have the right to issue visas so that people can go to their country, God. These people are going to be able to issue visas to enter the kingdom of God. I speak that embassies of the kingdom of God through this congregation will be all around this region. I speak in the name of Jesus that the unemployment rate of this church will be zero. Anybody that wants to work will work. I speak the doors will open. I speak favor. Those that are already working, their bosses, their employers, if they're not the employer themselves, their employers, their supervisors will look and say, wow, I am blessed to have him. I'm blessed to have her as part of my staff. And I speak that there will be raises and promotions and that there will be generosity. As we spoke in the confession this morning, the offertory confession, there will be a spirit of generosity upon these people to expand the kingdom of God. I speak the word, the blessing of the Lord. As I already said, this house will be a house of deliverance. This house will be a house of salvation. And I want to speak over this house a harvest of souls. Not just burned over people from other churches coming to this place. Not just burned out Christians who are discouraged with their own churches, but Lord, raw recruits. We speak the word of raw recruits. And my God, let the harvest be great. Let the harvest be great, so great that this auditorium would be inadequate in order to house what you're going to be doing in this place. Father, bring the wounded. Yes. Pastor, as David was rejected by the authorities that be, but went to the cave of Adullam, I think that's how you pronounce that, he went to that cave, and the debtors, the distressed, and the discontent came to him, and he formed a great army around them. So God is going to begin to bring unsaved people to this place that are in debt, not only in debt financially, just emotionally indebted, that are distressed, disheartened, discouraged. And there will be a wisdom upon this pastor and a wisdom upon this house to put people back together again. This is a really weird word. I've had it a few times. Great prophecy. Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again, but Jesus could. I see broken people like scrambled eggs coming to this place. God's going to give this house the ability to put lives back together. The Rolls Royce crowd isn't going to pull on to this parking lot. I mean, a few of them might, but not in great numbers. The people that God is going to call to this place are people that are in bondage, in addiction, slaves. But this house will put people back together again. Hallelujah! Give the Lord a praise offering.
Amen. All right. Well, I hope you guys were blessed. If you would, can we thank Dick Joyce again? Thank you so much for coming and ministering. Wanna release you guys. If you need to leave, you can go ahead and leave. We've got a ministry team up here somewhere. But we love to pray with you. Seriously, we do that every Sunday. So if you're here and you need healing, you came here for a specific thing that you want prayer for, we've got people that are gonna make their way across the front here and line up and love to pray with you. Otherwise, God bless you guys. Give someone a hug. Share a blessing with somebody, and we'll see you next week.